Morning, children.
Good morning, ma'am.
We were discussing about bryophytes in the previous class, and we learned there are two classes of bryophytes. Which are those two classes? Abhinav, name the two classes of bryophytes.
Liverworts and mosses.
And which is the predominant stage in mosses, Devika?
Gametophyte.
And the gametophyte has got two distinct phases or stages. Devi, which are those two?
Protonema stage and leafy stage.
And what is meant by protonema, Tulya? What did we learn about protonemal stage? From where are they?
Absent in the last class.
Yes, Sadulya?
Ma'am, I was absent in the last class.
That is not an excuse, Adulya. You should find out what was taken. Jyoti?
Yes, ma'am.
From where are they formed, protonema?
It develops directly from a spore.
What are the other features that we learned?
It is a creeping, green, branched and frequently filamentous.
Yes. Tell me about the leafy stage, Anne-Marie. Leafy stage.
It is developed from the secondary protonema as lateral buds.
Then? One more point is there. Lakshmi, what is the next point that we learned? In leafy members?
Spirally arranged leaves on the slender axis and it is upright. Then it is attached to the soil through the multicellular and branched.
Okay, so we'll continue. Children, if you haven't turned your videos on, I will not mark attendance. This already we had seen, but once again I'll repeat it. The predominant stage, cycle of a mose is gametophyte. It has got two distinct phases or stages. First stage is protonema and the second one is leafy stage. And protonema, it is developed directly from the spores. It's creeping and filamentous, green colored and branch structure. And the second stage is leafy stage. Leafy stage is developed from secondary protonema lateral buds. Some lateral buds can appear on secondary protonema and these will gradually develop into the leafy stage. And they are upright, then slender axes are present on which spirally leaves are arranged spirally. And the attachment to the soil is with the help of certain filamentous structures, which you call as rhizoid. So true roots, stems and leaves are absent. Instead, they have certain structures which perform the function of these vegetative parts. So this we had seen last class. And this stage bears the sex organs. So it's a leafy stage that consists of sex organs, which will help in producing the gametes, which can result in fertilization or sexual reproduction. Now let's see the different methods of reproduction found in mosses. Starting with the first one, vegetative reproduction. So just as we had already discussed, here also fragmentation. The plant body can break up into fragments and each fragment can grow into a new organism or by means of budding. In the secondary protonema, buds can arise and from these buds also reproduction can take place. Buds present on secondary protonema or by means of fragmentation. So these are the two vegetative methods of reproduction. Not only vegetative reproduction, they can carry out sexual reproduction too. Antheridia and Archegonia. Now you know what are Antheridia and Archegonia. Antheridia are the male sex organs, archegonia, female sex organs, archegonium, antheridium are singular. They are produced at the tip of the leafy shoots. So that is why in the previous slide I told you the leafy stage bears sex organs. At the tip of this leafy shoots you can find Antheridia and Archegonia. And they will produce the respective gametes. And once fertilization takes place, once the fusion of male and female gametes take place, zygote will be formed, and this zygote will develop into sporophyte. And the gametophyte is bearing the sex organs. And once the gametes fuse, it will result in the formation of a zygote. And the zygote will now develop into sporophyte. And the three main parts of the sporophyte we already discussed: foot, seta, and capsule. It is inside the capsule that spores are being produced. The sporophyte in Moses is more elaborate, more developed when compared to the sporophyte in liverworts. Here the sporophytic stage is a little more elaborate, a little more developed when compared to that in liverworts. And within the capsule, as we said in the case of liverworts, here also spores will be present, and spores are the result of meiotic division. Spores are formed as a result of meiotic division. Moses have got an elaborate mechanism of spore dispersal, and you know that the spores need to be dispersed just like the dispersal of seeds in order to form new plants, or in order these spores will germinate and form a new gametophyte. So they have an elaborate mechanism, a well developed mechanism for carrying out the dispersal of spores. So once again we'll see the different points. We were discussing about the reproduction taking place in Moses. We can categorize the methods of reproduction into two types: sexual reproduction and vegetative reproduction. Vegetative reproduction takes place by means of two methods. One is by fragmentation and the other one is by budding. Buds will be formed on secondary protonema, which can gradually develop into a new organism. And sexual reproduction is by means of gametes. And these gametes are produced within sex organs, Antheridium and Archegonium. And these sex organs will be found in the leafy stage. At the tip of the leafy shoots, you can find these sex organs, and both of them, they'll produce the respective gametes. Once the gametes are produced, the male gamete will fuse with the female gamete and the zygote will be formed. The zygote will gradually develop into sporophyte. Sporophyte has got three distinct parts: foot, seta, and capsule. And it is within this capsule that spores are formed as a result of meiotic division. And when compared to liverworts, here the sporophyte as well as the spore dispersal mechanisms are a little more elaborate. Okay? Okay, children?
Ma'am, I didn't finish the slide.
Okay. You want to note down the points or you want me to explain?
I want to note down the points.
Okay, carry on, carry on. Antheridium and Archegonium. Both of them are present at the tip of the leafy shoot. So it is asked, we learned about two stages, protonema and also leafy stage. Which stage of Moses bears the sex organs? It is leafy stage. At the tip of the leafy shoots, these sex organs are present. Within the sex organs, gametes will be produced, and these gametes will fuse and form a zygote. Once the zygote is formed, they can develop into sporophyte. There are three distinct stages for sporophyte: foot, seta, and capsule. And it is within the capsule that spores are formed, and the spore formation is by the process of meiotic division. And when compared to liverworts, they have a little more developed sporophyte as well as a mechanism for dispersing seeds. Spores. Jyoti completed?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Some examples of Moses you can find here: sphagnum, phinaria. Phinaria is the one which I told you, you know, on the rims of wells or covering the surface of rocks, on walls, and all you can find this particular moss. Then another example is also given, Polytrichum. Polytrichum, Funaria, Sphagnum. A few examples also you should know. Funaria, Sphagnum, Polytrichum are some examples. And in the picture you can see ceta capsule and the basal region which forms the foot. Sphagnum, Funaria, Polytrichum are some common examples for mosses. With that, we have completed bryophytes. Now, what is next, children?
Pteridophytes.
Pteridophytes. And before I proceed, in class 9, you had learned about these different divisions of plant kingdom. Thallophyta, Bryophyta and Pteridophyta. When compared to Thallophyta or algae, Bryophyta, what are the differences found in pteridophytes? Any difference can you say? Thallophyta or algae and bryophytes on one end, one side, and pteridophytes on the other hand. What are the differences? Two major differences. One already you know.
They live underwater.
Yes, Nimida?
So underwater.
No, not all are not underwater, no. Only algae. They are aquatic plants. But others need the presence of water. About the plant parts, well differentiated parts were absent in, or they are absent in bryophyta and thallophyta or algae. But here in pteridophytes, they have true stems, roots and leaves. Not as developed as higher plants, but still they have true roots, stems and leaves. And another point, in bryophytes as well as in thallophytes, they don't have any vascular tissues. What are vascular tissues? What are the examples? Two vascular tissues that you know. Xylem and phloem. They help in the transport of nutrients, water, etc. And these were absent in the case of bryophytes and also thallophytes. But pteridophytes, they have vascular tissues too. They have a better developed, or their plant body is differentiated into true roots, stems and leaves. And this feature is lacking in the other two divisions. And pteridophytes have got a well-developed vascular system too for the transport of nutrients and water. A few of you are not turning your videos on. Any genuine reasons? I don't think so. Many are having a reason for this. Children, reminding again, if you need attendance, please do turn it on. Pteridophytes, that is a third division we need to learn. On either side, you can see two categories of plants. Horsetails and ferns. Horsetail got the name because it resembles the tail of a horse. Then ferns. Ferns you are very familiar with. And they include, pteridophytes include two main categories, horsetails and ferns. They are found in cool, wet or damp, shady places. So just like in the case of bryophytes, these two are found in very cool, damp, shady places. And some of them, they flourish well or they grow well in sandy soil conditions. Certain types, they can grow well in sandy soil. Generally, they prefer cool, damp and shady places. And they are considered to be the first terrestrial plants. We have higher plants and animals, but these are the first terrestrial plants to have xylem and phloem, or they have vascular tissues. And thallophyta and bryophyta were not having these vascular tissues. So you can find vascular tissues in pteridophyta. These are the first terrestrial plants to have these vascular tissues. A few more examples you can see here. Selaginella. Selaginella, I think you might have seen. For decorative purposes and all, this used to be, this particular plant is used. Selaginella, fern. Fern, I think all might have seen fern. Yes, children? If you haven't seen, by next period I will arrange. Have you seen fern growing near the ponds or near the wells? Also you can find, and at the back side you might have noticed some powdery thing, powdery structure, and this when you press on your hand you will get, or it will leave a white impression there similar to the shape of the leaf. Anybody have done? No.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next period let me see whether I can get one. I'll show you. In bryophytes, the dominant phase is gametophyte. So here also, the dominant phase is gametophyte, just as in the case of bryophytes. Sorry, in bryophytes, the dominant phase is gametophyte, but in pteridophytes, unlike them, the sporophyte is the major phase. So gametophyte is a dominant phase or major phase in the case of bryophytes, whereas in the case of pteridophytes, sporophyte is the dominant phase. And here you can find true root, stem and leaves. Plant body is differentiated into true root, stem and leaves, whereas in bryophytes as well as in thallophytes, no well differentiated plant parts are there. But when it comes to bryophyte, they have certain structures which resemble stem, roots and leaves, but not true root, stems and leaves. But in case of pteridophytes, they have vascular tissues, they have true roots, stems and leaves. Okay, so those two are the features which distinguish it from the other two divisions, thallophyta and bryophyta. Well differentiated, well developed vascular tissues, that is xylem and phloem, and they also have well differentiated plant parts. True root, stem and leaves are present, and the dominant phase is sporophyte, unlike the dominant phase in bryophytes. In bryophytes, the dominant phase is gametophyte, but here the dominant phase is sporophyte. And the leaves, you can categorize or classify them based on its size. If you take the case of fern, you can find the leaves are big in size, they are large, whereas in Selaginella, you can see the leaves are very small, small sized leaves. So if the leaves are small in size, you call it as microphylls. And when they are big in size, macrophylls. So what is the difference between macrophylls and microphylls? Microphylls are small sized leaves. Macrophylls are large sized leaves, or leaves which are large in size. So example for microphylls in Selaginella, you can find small sized leaves or microphylls, whereas in ferns you can see large or big leaves and you call it as macrophyll. So you should be familiar with the examples. Once again, the dominant phase is gametophyte in bryophytes, whereas in the case of pteridophyte it is sporophyte. And they have two features which are absent in bryophytes and algae. They have well differentiated vascular tissues and true root, stems and leaves. And the leaves can be categorized into microphylls and macrophylls based on its size. When they are large in size, you call it as macrophylls. When they are small in size, you call it as microphylls. Example, Selaginella for microphylls and ferns for macrophylls. They are used for medicinal purposes. So different pteridophytes, different uses. So some of them are used for medicinal purposes. They are used as soil binders. So just like in the case of mosses, we said this also will help in binding the soil and preventing soil erosion. They can be grown as ornamental plants. So they look very attractive or very appealing, and so this can be grown as ornamentals for decorative purpose. In the gardens also you can grow these plants. Used as or grown as ornamentals, they act as soil binders and they have medicinal, some of them are having medicinal value. They are used for medicinal purposes and they can be used as soil binders also, and many of them can be grown as ornamentals. Now moving on to its reproduction. So far is it clear, children? So let me check whether you have understood. What are the points that we discussed? Anne Mary, are you there? Yes. What did we learn about pteridophytes? Just list one point.
They are found in cool, damp, shady regions and sandy soil.
Okay. Alina?
It is differentiated into true roots, stems and leaves.
Yes, Alina, can you speak a little louder? Don't check anywhere, Alina.
It is differentiated in roots, leaves and stems.
Plant body has got true stem, roots and leaves. Then, Anishwara.
Anishwari, they are the first terrestrial plants to possess vasculars of tissues.
Okay, next point. Aditya Dev. Shreya, Aditya Dev, Ardra, Sanjana, Samia, John, Basma, focus on your face. Yes. Whom did I ask? Sanjana. Sanjana?
Yes, ma'am.
What happened to your video? Give me the answer. Next point. We learned a few points about pteridophytes. So 2 points your classmate said. What are the remaining points? Aditya Dev? I forgot I asked you. Okay. Aditya Dev?
They are soil binders.
They are soil binders. Last. Okay. They act as soil binders. Turn your video on. Ardra? Another point? Ardra Priyagosh, Anjana Sunil.
They can be grown as ornamentals.
They can be grown as ornamentals. Then Mehrin.
Yes, ma'am.
What happened to you? Any connective tissue?
Yes, ma'am. Connective tissue.
Okay, give me the answer.
In bryophytes, the dominant phase is a gametophyte.
Okay, enough. Alan? Next point.
They are used for medicinal purposes.
Yes, Alan?
They are used for medicinal purposes.
Not able to follow what you're saying.
Ma'am, they are used for medicinal purposes.
Ivo? Ivo, next point.
The leaves can be the macrophylls or microphylls.
Leaves can be the macrophylls or microphylls. When they are small in size, you call it as microphylls. And when they are large in size, macrophylls. One important point you're missing. Which is that point, Alendina?
Dominant phase is chlorophyll.
That was told. One important point. 2 differences I told you, no, of pteridophytes when compared to
well-differentiated vascular tissue.
They have got well-differentiated vascular tissues, so xylem and phloem. So we'll continue.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Show me the first slide of pteridophytes.
First slide of
pteridophytes.
Pteridophytes. Who was saying? Yes, Nimida, what is your doubt?
I didn't write a poem.
Which slide you want to see? First one, second one, first one. Okay. Is this the one? No, I think the previous one, no? This one. Yes, Nimida?
Yes.
Pteridophytes include host tails and ferns, and they are found in cool, damp, shady places, and even on sandy soil, you can see them growing well. They are the first terrestrial plants to have vascular tissues. Okay, Nimida? Okay. Next is about the methods of reproduction. The sporophytes, and we learned that sporophyte is the dominant phase. Sporophytes bear sporangia, singular sporangium, that are subtended by leaf-like appendages called sporophylls. So they have sporangia. Sporophyte is the main plant body, and they have sporangia or sporangium inside which spores are being produced. And these sporangia will be present on the lower surface of leaf-like appendages or leaf-like structures. So they have sporophylls. And on the lower side, see here you can see the picture of a fern. And on the lower side, you can see certain structures, sporangia are present, and within the sporangium, the spores will be produced. So the main plant body is sporophyte, and the sporophyte is having sporangium. Sporangium are the structures where spores are produced, and the spores are usually present on the lower surface of the leaf, and these structures or these leaves where spores are produced, you call it as sporophylls. Spore bearing leaves are known as sporophylls. And here you can see a structure, just a minute. It's not mentioned in your textbook, but it means a cluster of sporangia. A group of sporangia is known as spore, and sporophylls are the leaf-like structures where these spores are produced. Sporangia are present, and within the sporangium, spores will be produced. Once again, the main sporus is singular, spora is plural. So sporophyte is the main plant body. Sporophytes contain sporangia. Sporangia, where the spores are produced, they are present on the lower surface of the leaf-like appendages, and those structures you call it as sporophyll. And as I told you, we call them as megaphyll or macrophylls. And the small leaves you call it as microphyll. In certain cases, sporophylls, they will form certain structures. So in the previous figure, you saw some leaf-like structures known as sporophylls, on the lower side of which you can see sporangia. But in certain other pteridophytes, you can see sporophylls, they form cone-like structures. As you can see in the figure, some cone-like structures are produced. We call it as strobili or strobilus. And these are found in plants like Selaginella and Equisetum. So instead of having a leaf-like structure, these sporophylls will form cone-like structures. And these cones are known as strobili. Once again, sporophyte is the main plant body in pteridophytes. And the sporophylls contain sporangia. Sporophylls are the leaf-like appendages where the spores are being produced. So on lower surface of the leaf, you can see sporangia. Within the sporangia, spores will be produced. But in certain other pteridophytes, they don't have a leaf-like structure where the spores are produced. Instead, the sporophylls will form some cone or compact structures, as you can see in the figure, which you call as strobili. Example, selaginella and equisetum. Now coming to the methods of reproduction. Sporangia. See, in this figure also you can find within the sporangium. Sporangium present on the lower surface of the leaf. You can find spores produced sporangium. Sporangium on the lower surface of the leaf. Within the sporangium, spores are produced and these spores will germinate and form the gametophyte. Sporangia produce spores. And that takes place by means of meiotic division. So within the sporangium, there are spore mother cells. And these spore mother cells will undergo reduction division and they will form haploid spores. Sporophyte produces sporangium, or sporophyte has got some sporophylls or leaf-like appendages on the lower side of which sporangia are present, and within the sporangium spores are produced, and these spores are produced by reduction division in the spore mother cells. Children, so many rhyming words, you can get confused. So once again I'll explain it. So we learned a few terms: sporophyte, sporophyll, sporangia, spore mother cells, and finally spores. So don't get confused between all these terms: sporophyte, sporophyll, sporangia, spore mother cells, and spores. What is sporophyte? Sporophyte is the dominant phase in pteridophytes. The sporophyte is the plant body which produces spores. And in sporophyte, where are the spores produced? They have some specialized. Sporophyte is having specialized leaf-like structures. And these leaf-like structures you call as sporophylls. And what is the connection between sporangia and sporophylls? It is on the lower surface of these sporophylls, sporangia, some sac-like structures are there. And within the sporangia, spore mother cells are present. And these spore mother cells will undergo meiotic division and they will form haploid spores. I'll repeat once again: sporophyte and sporophyll. You should not get confused between these two. Sporophyte, phyte is for the plant body. Phyll, that is for the leaf. Sporophyte is a plant body which is dominant in pteridophytes. Sporophyte bears sporophylls, leaf-like appendages, you call it as sporophylls. It can be either leaf-like and it can become form some compact structures known as strobili also. Whatever it is, the sporophyte is having sporophylls. Within the sporophylls, or on the lower side to be specific, on the lower surface of these leaves, sac-like structures are present, which you call as sporangia, singular sporangium. And within the sporangium, spores will be produced. And how are these spores produced? By meiotic division. And there are some spore mother cells within the sporangium which will undergo reduction division and form spores. Any confusion between these terms, children? Sporophyte, sporophylls, sporangia, spores. Sporophyte, phyte for the plant body, gametophyte, sporophyte. And phyll is for leaf, macrophyll, microphyll. And on the lower surface of these sporophylls, sporangia are formed. Sporangium or sporangia are structures where spores will be formed. And which process results in the formation of spores? Meiotic division. Which cells are carrying out meiotic division to form spores? They have certain spore mother cells. I hope now you don't have any confusion. Yes? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Only when you unmute and speak, I will be able to hear, okay? I just want to know how far you have understood, whether you have some confusion. Only if you respond, I will be able to understand. Sporangia produce spores by meiosis in spore mother cells. And these spores will germinate. As you can see in the figure, these spores will germinate and they will form gametophyte. Inconspicuous means not very prominent, indistinct, small, multicellular but free living, mostly photosynthetic, thalloid, gametophyte, and you call it as prothallus. The sporophyte is differentiated into true root, stems, leaves, etc. But gametophyte is having a thalloid structure. Here sporophyte, in case of pteridophytes, sporophyte is the dominant plant body and it is differentiated into root, stems and leaves. True root, stems and leaves. But the spores produced by the sporophyte will germinate and form a gametophyte. In gametophyte, the plant body is thalloid. It is not differentiated as in the case of sporophyte. It is inconspicuous, small, multicellular, free living, and they are photosynthetic. And you call the structure, the thalloid gametophyte in pteridophytes is prothallus. Okay, any doubt? Is it clear? So, sporophyte produces spores, and where are the spores produced in sporophyte? In the sporangium. Where are sporangia present? On sporophylls. What are sporophylls? Those leaf-like structures you call as sporophylls. And on the lower surface of sporophylls, sporangia are present. Within the sporangia, spore mother cells are there, and these spore mother cells will undergo reduction division and form haploid spores. And what happens to these haploid spores? They will germinate and form the next phase in their life cycle, that is gametophyte. But here the gametophyte is inconspicuous, small and thalloid, not differentiated as in the case of sporophyte. That is why we say sporophyte is the dominant phase, and the gametophyte here has got a specific name, prothallus, that is known as prothallus. And you can see the picture of prothallus here, heart-shaped structure. Prothallus requires cool, damp, shady places to survive. It requires water for fertilization. And that is why water can be a limiting factor affecting the distribution of pteridophytes. Since they need water for reproduction, pteridophytes cannot flourish well in all the areas. They are limited to narrow geographical areas, because in the absence of water, they will not be able to survive in that area. Even though they are terrestrial plants, they also need water for fertilization, just like in the case of bryophytes. And hence the spread of pteridophytes is limited, and they are found only in certain locations, certain geographic locations. And the prothallus or the gametophyte is the structure. From the name gametophyte itself, you know, it consists of, see the figure, both antheridium and archegonium are found on this prothallus. See the figure displayed. Archegonium, antheridium. So prothallus bears both antheridium and archegonium, the male and female sex organs, which will produce the respective gametes. Upon fusing, they'll result in the formation of a zygote. So prothallus requires cool, damp, shady places to grow. It requires water for fertilization, and that is why it can be asked why the spread of pteridophytes is limited, or why their distribution is limited to certain geographic geographical locations. The reason is they need the presence of water for fertilization. So water can be a limiting factor. And prothallus, what is prothallus? Prothallus is the inconspicuous small multicellular gametophyte of pteridophytes. It is thalloid structure and you call it as prothallus. And both sex organs, antheridia and archegonia, are found on this prothallus. We'll be continuing in the next class. So quickly summarize the points that we discussed just now about the gametophyte and sporophyte. What are the points that we learned? Pteridophytes, what are the points that we learned? It includes horse tails and ferns. What else, children? Quickly tell me. What is prothallus? Meryl, what is meant by prothallus?
Ma'am, they are inconspicuous, small multicellular, free living, mostly photosynthetic thalloid gametophyte
structure. You call it as prothallus. And where are antheridia and archegonia present, Devika, in pteridophytes? Where can you find the sex organs?
Ma'am, in the gametophyte.
What do you call the gametophyte in pteridophytes?
Gametophyte is known as antheridia and archegon.
Gametophyte, not sex organ. Just now I asked the question. Gametophytes are, you said that gametophyte is having these sex organs. And what is the other name for gametophyte here in pteridophytes?
Prothallus.
Prothallus. And where are the spores produced in a sporophyte? Tom, where are the spores produced?
Sporangia.
Where is the sporangium present? Gaya, where is the sporangium present?
Lower side of sporophylls.
Sporophylls. And within the sporangium, what are present? Ardra, within the sporangium, what can you find? Ardra? Mehrin? Within the sporangium, what are there which will undergo reduction division? Unmute and speak, Mehrin.
Spore mother cells.
Cells, it will undergo.
Spore mother cells. Spore mother cells.
Yes, yes. That will undergo reduction division and they will form spores. Okay. Thank you, children. See you next period.